Good morning. How are you doing? Fantastic. Oh man, what a week. I'm glad you're with us today. We have something a little different than we had planned. We've been planning these monthly kind of small special videos to be sharing with you guys each month. But this week, because of the snow, the storm, the power outages, and mostly the Kyle being unavailable, we have to postpone some of that. This is what happens when we lose our tech genius. But man, what a week. I hope you all have been safe. I hope you've been warm. I had friends in Texas emailing me that their power's been out for like a week and they've been scrambling to find places to stay. And it's been crazy. It's been a crazy time. I've been reflecting a lot this week. Maybe you have. Being stuck inside amidst being stuck inside has caused me to reflect a bit. But it was 1 year ago this week that I was in the hospital for the first time in my life. I'd never been in the hospital ever. And I spent 3 nights there awaiting surgery, literally being in the booth with the laser on me. They were looking for where to cut to do my surgery, and miraculously on that like bed lying there, the infection was gone. They couldn't find it and I was good to go. And it was such a crazy time. I've been thinking about it a lot, feeling so vulnerable and so powerless. And it's crazy because it's like the exact same lesson that I've been learning all year, from something totally different. You know what I mean? I don't know if you've been learning this lesson, feeling this lesson, but just the sheer vulnerability and fragility of this life. I've been reflecting on the book that I read a while back, had kind of been reading different parts through during COVID, by Richard Rohr, called Falling Upward. I'm not sure if you've heard of this book, but it's so powerful and it's been so helpful for me during this time. He talks about what he calls the two halves of life, first and second half, and he illustrates them in many ways. But I really like the comparison that he makes between John the Baptist and Jesus. John the Baptist is the symbol of the like first half of life, where I know for me, I can see, we can see this in a lot of teenagers as well. You're overly zealous. You're only concerned about being right, about being perfect, about being best, and being biggest and important, and knowing everything and understand. And in religion, it takes the form of what we call righteousness, right? You assert your righteousness over and against other people. And oh man, this was like my jam when I was on fire for Jesus. I loved being righteous, not doing things that other people were doing and declaring and asserting my righteousness. And think about how crazy it is that I would equate being on fire with Jesus, whatever that means, with constantly asserting my righteousness on others. I loved debating with people, especially about religion. And you see, you know, a lot of people get stuck there. They never move beyond the religion of John the Baptist. It's always accusing other people, always pointing out other people's faults. It's filled with threats. This is how John ends his sermon in Matthew chapter 3. This is like his altar call, okay? His winnowing fork is in his hands, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Offering plates are in the back. He's like threatening them into the kingdom of God. Like you can shove or push somebody into true transformation. Rohr uses John as a symbol of what he calls the first half of life. And he doesn't mean that necessarily chronologically, like, you know, you're before you're 40 and then after you're 40, anything like that. You can meet very young people who, because of suffering or because of extraordinary circumstances, are already in the second half of life. They're already moved in that stage. Or you can meet very old people who are still like babies. So it's not chronological. It's where the soul is. How much you've learned from what you have loved and what you have suffered. And the second half of life is symbolized by Jesus, according to Rohr. As John says right before the verse we just read, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with fire and with the Holy Spirit." It's a perfect illustration of the difference between the symbolic and the real, right? So water doesn't change us. I've been baptized. You've probably been baptized. I love to do baptisms, but there's nothing actually transformational about the water per se. That's what John is saying, but it's a symbol for the real change, the real baptism that is coming, he says, the baptism of the Holy Spirit and of fire. And this is when we really get the point. Now, hopefully this will happen sometime, somewhere in the middle of life, after we've loved a bit, suffered a bit, failed a bit, rejoiced a bit, lived a bit, but we never get to start there. We don't start there. We all start with the religion of John the Baptist. We try to show how zealous we are. It's all symbolized by like asceticism, right? Eating locusts. That's what they said that John did. He ate locusts. Why? Why? What are you trying to prove? John, I remember I spent an entire summer in Africa because of the religion of John the Baptist. I remember I was in college, and each summer they had, you know, mission trips that if you wanted to kind of give up your summer and go and preach Jesus, you could do these mission trips. And there was one going to Africa, and I was like, Africa? On a mission trip, that is the most Christian thing I could do. And I was like so on fire and so, yes, let's do it. And then I heard this is a week-long mission trip, but some people choose to give up and stay there after the team leaves. And you can stay the entire summer and preach Jesus in Africa. And I was like, that's who I am. I gotta go. I gotta do it. And listen, I don't regret it. I don't regret it. That's the thing. We don't get to look back at our at that previous stages and judge, because it's needed. It's part of this growth and this change. It's part of us telling the world I matter. But you see what this religion looks like at times. You see the byproduct at times. John is so judgmental. He's so angry. Listen again in Matthew chapter 3. He says, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" He's almost like he doesn't want them to be converted. I don't know how much that we would like John if we met him, you know? But he's a prophet, and he's a pretty important prophet. But as Rohr says, he's like a saint for the first half of life. When you're young, you have to find something to dig into. You know what I mean? You have to find an identity. You're looking all around for your identity, whether it's being the smartest or the best dancer or the best gamer or the best musician or having the biggest truck or whatever it is, it's necessary and it's usually pretty stupid, right? But when you're young, that's what's important to you. That's what you think success is. It's about being the best at blank, right? Being the richest and best looking and all of that. Richard Rohr in his book calls this building your container. Building your container. Psychologists would say that you're building your ego structure or your house, saying to the world, I am important, I matter, and this is why. It's where we stake our flag. And our kids are constantly doing this all the time. Papa, watch this, is a phrase I hear constantly, constantly. And it's my child building her container. She's saying, I matter. And they have to do it. And we can't take that away from them, right? But that very identity that we've built for ourselves in the first half of life, the identity that's zealous and righteous and opinionated, Man, that is why kids are so hard to raise. They're so darn opinionated about things that don't matter, but they don't know that yet, right? But we should know that yet, right? So we have to affirm their necessary successes and victories and passions. I think that's definitely what my parents did. I'm sure they were a bit eye-rolly behind the scenes when I told them at 18 that I was going to Bible college to be a pastor. Like, okay, you know, but they supported me. And I have, you know, rarely regretted the decision. But it started with me proving to myself and to the world, I am really serious about this Jesus thing. Let me show you. Right? It starts with our own ego, our own superiority and specialness, saying, I matter, but this house, this container that we've built according to Roar, it has to come down. It has to be destroyed. The axe is set at the root of the tree. You thought you were the best country, the best religion, the best political party, the best gender, the best, pick it, right? It doesn't matter. It's always the best, and it's always you. That ego structure has to fall apart. It has to fall apart because it isn't true. It's all about you. It's not about life or love or God. It's the first, if the first half of life is about zeal and ambition, the second half of life is basically about compassion. It's a whole different agenda. You're not concerned about being number one. You're not concerned about your people being best, your political party, your religion, your way. That's never going to bring peace. It's never going to bring us together and heal us. And that's why we're here. That's what our community is all about. It's us moving forward into that second half of life, not following the religion of John the Baptist, but following the religion of Jesus, looking for wisdom instead of just knowledge, understanding instead of just information. That's what we're going for here at the Oregon community. That's the religion of Jesus. And that transformation, I'm sorry to say, but it comes with pain. It usually comes through pain if we can handle it properly. And that's what this that's what this year has been for me, man. It's been a tough year. It's been a really tough year. And I trust that it's been like that for you in many, many ways. And in this moment where there's so much that has been stripped away and is being stripped away, I pray that we would sense the Spirit of God leading us into this new stage, into this new life, showing us what really, really actually matters, what's really true, what's really universally true, not just true in America, not just true in Portland, but capital T truth. I want to find that. And that that comes through fire, and it comes through things falling down, and it comes through pain. But that's how we grow. That's just how we grow. I want to share with you one of my favorite songs about transformation, about conversion, about healing, about pain, all this stuff. Simple song, beautiful song by Johnny Lang. I love you guys. I hope you have a great week. We'll see you next week on the other side.
Struggle without end. Although bitter times, those were the days that I began to understand I was only a man. I grew up singing songs in church with questions in my mind, then turned my back and ran away from God who gave me life. Then one night His presence fell, I wept and shook in me. I fell down and cried, "Dear Jesus, rescue me again." I understand I am only a man. And He said, "What will it be now? Will you choose me or keep swimming upstream now? I've been inside your head, hearing you scream out, but here I am, just take my hand and I'll take out all of the pain and all of the fear, all of the fear."
May the Lord lift up His countenance.